It's great to be here, and it's an important subject, an interesting subject, and we have a great panel. I'm just going to go by their first names, but Lucy, who's with The Economist, does research for The Economist, and is along with DuPont, has prepared an index of how countries are doing all over the world with respect to food security, the good, the bad, best practices, worst practices. So it's really important. Jorg is with Nestle, the largest food company in the world. I'm not sure he wants me to tell you this, but Jorg has climbed the seven summits, including Mount Everest. So as far as I'm concerned, he's the most qualified person on the panel to talk about anything. Linda is my friend for many years with DuPont, and previously had been with the Environmental Protection Agency, but is very much involved in food policy-related issues. And Esther is our honest-to-goodness farmer who is here, and she's also a researcher at Auburn University, but she farms in Kenya. So we have a good, balanced group. And, you know, the title of this panel says, basically, innovations in food security and nutrition. It really ought to have added the word health to it, because there's the old French philosopher who said, you are what you eat. And too often we don't talk about food and health and being adequately fed with a diverse diet in the same context of living a long and healthy life and preventing disease. So I make the point today that a lot of people, maybe when they talk about health issues, they don't think about food. But what goes in your mouth is a giant determiner about how long you'll live and how healthy you'll be. And it's something that I think that needs to be added to this. But the topic specifically is food security. And that word is bantied around today like no other in the policy field. And, you know, what is food security? Is it too little food? Is it a humanitarian issue? Is it not enough of the right kind of food, so you get undernutrition by not having a diverse diet? Is it obesity, which is overnutrition? Is it preparing against humanitarian disasters? Is it providing a system of agriculture where a country can produce enough nutritious food for their own people or not? And is it global? Is it just in the developing world, or is it in the United States as well? You know, and I think we're going to find that these issues of food security are worldwide. In fact, of course, we have about one out of every seven persons in the United States that is periodically on the SNAP program, and they're often called food insecure people. But I think most of our discussion today will be global about how we deal with the issue of food security, and nutrition, eating the right kinds of foods, getting a full, diverse diet in the modern world. So I'm going to start with Lucy, because Lucy works for The Economist. And The Economist, of course, is a world-renowned magazine and research organization that has been analyzing these issues country by country worldwide. And I would maybe ask you to talk a little bit about your work, and then also define food security. What is it we're talking about today?
Yeah, thanks, Dan. I'd be glad to. And you've just hit on the central problem that we had when we first started with this index, when DuPont came to us and indicated that they wanted to do a research piece on food security. They came to the EIU because they know that we are good at modeling, I don't want to call it the impossible, but big, broad topics that are hard to understand, that are multifaceted, multidimensional. The EIU does a global peace index. We do a democracy index. So when they came to us to talk about food security, it was just our kind of challenge, having modeled those other issues. So our first big step with any index or model is to define what are we measuring and why. And we knew that we had to have a broad measure. We knew that a lot of work had been done in the food security space. So our first step was to take a look at what were the common definitions of food security that were, you know, recognized amongst all the stakeholders. And fortunately, we had, you know, a lot of great bodies of work to draw upon, and probably the most helpful was the work that was done at the World Food Summit in 1996, where several important parameters were established. access to good food is a human right, you know, like access to health, access to any of these basic human needs. So that important, you know, scene was set. And we also knew that, you know, there had to be a broad definition. So this is the definition that we worked on. We adapted it from these time-honored and respected ones. And I'm going to read it out in all, it's like a poem. Every single word has great meaning. So food security exists when all people at all times have physical, social, and economic access to sufficient and nutritious food that meets their dietary needs for a healthy and active life. Now, each word has meaning, and each word was then taken into a specific measure. The index that we came up with has 19 specific measures of food security, ranging from three broad categories. The first is affordability. Is the food system within the country providing affordable food to all people at all times? Availability. Is the food system making food available to everyone at all times? And then, is the food that's being delivered of a nutritious and healthy and safe quality? So with this overarching definition in place, we had our three broad categories, and we went to work on 19 specific areas of measurement. And you know, over the past 4 years, we've been able to identify, you know, some sort of key elements that must be in place for countries to be food secure. We tend to look at it from a risk standpoint, but also as an opportunity and a, you know, what needs to be in place standpoint. So we know that there must be some sort of nutritional tracking. There must be some body within the country that tracks the nutritional outcomes for that country and also sets some sort of standard. What is the daily consumption meant to look like? But, and over time, we know what's really become important is the nutritional quality of that input. And I know the rest of the panel will have a lot to say about that later.
So let me ask you something. So how many countries have you measured?
We've measured 109 countries from developed to developing. We didn't want to. We wanted to have all income groups.
Did you measure the United States, curiously?
Yes. The U.S. actually does quite well.
And are you seeing improvement? How many years have you done this, by the way?
We've done this for 4 years, and probably the biggest areas of improvement have been with the low and lower middle income countries. These were, of course, the countries who had the farthest to go with improvements, but I think we've seen that improvements in the efficiencies of their food systems based on government prioritization of the sector, based on, which of course leads to infrastructure improvements that mitigates food loss, and also, of course, makes food more available to people. Also, the nutritional standards and government, you know, focus on, you know, access to potable water, access to efficient food market structures. All these things have helped.
And have you seen any health outcomes yet from the measurements that you've done?
The health outcomes that we've seen is specifically measured in, you know, prevalence of undernourishment and prevalence of stunting and some of the health-related, micronutrient-related outcomes. And we have seen an improvement in both of these categories.
And can you find this online? This
yes.
Can you
give them the? Glad you asked. It's foodsecurityindex.eiu.com. There's a report, summary report, a model, and then a whole library of materials that we've developed
Great.
Over the time.
So I'm going to go to you, Jorg. You represent the largest food company in the world, global company. You're headquartered in Switzerland, but your huge presence in the United States, huge presence in the developed and the developing world. So how does Nestle look at this problem of food security? What have you been doing to try to deal with it?
I think when you look at food security, you need to look at your basic strategy as a company. And Nestle has decided in 2006 already to move a company from a consumer goods company to a nutrition, health, and wellness company. What does it mean to move to a nutrition, health, and wellness company? The focus of its actions and of its business has shifted from simple consumer fast-moving goods in order to provide higher value to the consumer and to change the whole company to satisfy that need. Within that strategy, food security is of utmost importance because we are operating in countries where food security is an issue. And if we operate in these countries, we have a responsibility as a big global food player, also to address the issue of food security. As a business principle, we, however, do not believe, and this is maybe different from other speakers, we do not believe that donations, that foundations, that programs that have temporary funding moving in and moving out are going to be a sustainable solution. In some countries, such as in India, we operate for 100 years. In the Philippines, we operate for 85 years, people knowing the brand already from the grandparents to the children. So here we believe in the creating shared value approach to say, on the one hand, we need to make business because we are a business. We need to satisfy our shareholders. On the other hand, we can only operate for 100 years in the country if we deliver and give something back to society. And here, very clearly, from a principle, we have to match both of those. And food security is a very important thing. And just one example is fortification. We have made external commitments, so public commitments, that we want to deliver up to 2016, 200 billion servings of fortified foods globally.
200 billion servings?
200 billion
servings. Fortified foods, okay.
By 2016, we are now, we're counting. So that is also something which is very important. You need to be transparent in what you do. You need to measure it, and you need to prove it. So we are now at 182 billion servings, if I'm not mistaken, at the moment. But we also want to go further, and that comes back to your question, what is the health outcome? Not only the output showing that this is what we sell, but what is actually the benefit for the population in order to really have an impact on the society.
And with the servings, like is it a prepared, prepackaged meal or different kinds of things?
That's different kinds of things. For example, in the Philippines, where we do, where we have actually research ongoing, is fortified milks. So you have individualized packaged milks, and they are substituted with water, and then given to children for 1 year and above. And here, that one serving is approximately 20% of the food intake of a child per day. We have the same in infant cereals. For example, I just come from Indonesia, where we have infant cereals also addressed to a very vulnerable population. And it can be like in Nigeria or in a lot of African countries, where we have a muggy cube, which is a cube, a bouillon cube, used for cooking with a penetration rate of about 88%. So virtually every household is using that cube in order to cook at home. So it's used for any type of cooking.
And you sell this. This is not, is this is donated, or is the this is all this, sold as part of a business model?
This is not part of creating shared value. So this is sold. But it is sold with ingredients, with food science and technology behind, so that it addresses the public health issues in the country. For example, in the Philippines, we changed the milk composition and put much more iron into it, because iron deficiency anemia is a big issue, which poses a lot of technological problems, because iron is very reactive in the food. But we invested money in order to address that public health issue, also to differentiate ourselves from our competitors and saying, we are addressing a public health issue in the country by increasing our iron content in the foods. So we are, that's the advantage of being a big global corporation with more than 450 factories globally, that our food is locally produced, so we can also address locally the demands because we produce locally.
Okay, so I think it's useful to go from Nestle to DuPont. DuPont is always identified more as a company that deals with farmers. And you can't talk about these issues without talking about farmers. And we're going to get to Esther last but not least in this regard. But DuPont sells seeds, sells inputs, both here in the United States, the famous company, Pioneer Seed Company. Mm-hmm. Any farmers in the room by any chance? Anybody? Okay, got a few. Anybody grow anything in their gardens by any chance? Okay, all right. So you're farmers. Okay. So anyway, but you sell inputs, you have relations, and you also have other products as well. And often, you know, companies like you are often caught up in a lot of political battles about, the whole GMO issue and other mm-hmm. kinds of things. But I wonder if you could talk about how you view the food security issue and what DuPont is doing, because I know you're very active, particularly in the African subcontinent, but right. Perhaps other places as well.
So thank you. DuPont sees itself as a differentiator in that we believe good science and innovation will bring about much greater yields, much more nutritious food. But while science is global, the solution has to be local. So we are working in various countries in partnerships, in collaborations, many times with aid organizations. So a first step might be with an aid organization. But the ultimate goal, obviously, is to get a farmer that is capable of growing food for himself, for his family, and for the market, so that they have cash, so that they can reinvest in their farm, in their kids' education, and lead a better life. Sometimes, frequently in with small holders, you really do need to work with an NGO or an aid organization to start and build that capacity. We will use our science to figure out what are the right seeds to grow in those particular areas, what are the right crops. We've had projects in India where they, in places where they are traditionally rice farmers, but drought is becoming a real problem. So we have seen kind of one of our goals is to try to find the right corn seeds, that maize seeds that can substitute for rice, so that in spite of the drought, corn is much less takes much less water. Those farmers will have a crop that, again, they can both use for themselves and sell. So we really try to work locally and figure out what's the right combination of seeds, of crop protection chemicals, of packaging that will help those farmers be successful, of training, of fertilizer.
So when the question is asked, it's in the program today, can we feed another 2.5 billion people, assuming we're going to go to 9.5 billion people in 30 years or whatever the number is, how do you see that issue? Can we do it? And what are the primary strategies? And
we have to do it. Start there. Okay. Well, this comes back to, the Food Security Index. At DuPont, we think there's a lot of solutions that we want to be a part of. And again, we look at that as seeds, as inputs, as training, technical information. We now know a lot more about how to improve soil quality, how we can test soil quality to give the farmer information about when to plant their seed, how much fertilizer. So, you know, all kinds of technologies make a difference. But there's a lot more than just inputs and technology. And when you look at, and I encourage everybody to take the time to go on the Food Security Index website. It's interesting to play around with. And you see that it's going to take a lot of different pieces of the puzzle. DuPont has a role to play, but a lot of it is going to be in politics and in understanding kind of where the nutritional deficits are and developing the pipelines to get the food grown and to market and those sorts of things. So there's a lot of pieces to the puzzle.
So I'm just going
to
ask you this question. So often in this political debate about technology and agriculture, you hear in some circles, well, companies like DuPont and Monsanto and Syngenta and Bayer Crop Science, and I'm sure there are others, all they want to do is to turn sub-Saharan Africa and the developing world into American agriculture. How do you respond to that? I mean, big-scale industrial
You're
American
right.
agriculture.
Do we want everywhere to look like Nebraska is what people will say to me. Well, we want to see successful farmers, and they're not going to look like America, and we're not really taking just the solutions that work in America and exporting them because they will fail. And how you work with very smallholder farmers and make them successful is going to be very different than how you work with a large-scale farmer in North America. So that's why we're investing a lot on the ground, working with farmers, with technology that's going to work in their location with all of their conditions that are pretty unique. If somebody is saying that in a way, do we want them to be successful? Yeah, we do. Do we want them to be doing everything, you know, like we do in America? It won't work. But we do want them to be much more successful.
So let's turn to an actual farmer in the developing world. Although, Esther, you also are a researcher at Auburn University. Great school, great football team, whatever else there is, you know. I went to Michigan, so we have various things here. So as a smallholder farmer, tell us a little bit about what you do and your farm, and then how you see this issue of food security and nutrition as well.
Thank you so much, and may I say I represent every smallholder farmer that will not be here presently, and I really want them to be successful, but not to have their farms looking like every American farm. And yes, you asked, how do we want to farm? First of all, we know the problems is, our soil is depleted. And I'm a researcher, so first of all, we take it back to the soil. What we are realizing is that the soil actually has trillions of helpers that have just been waiting for us to just take a look at them and say, hey, we're here. And so they're there. And we want to, but then we want to first of all understand who are there, who are these partners? There are billions of them. They want to help us to first of all make our soils healthy, because without healthy soils, we won't have anything. Even if you put the right amount of fertilizers and everything, you're still going to fail. So as a smallholder farmer, first of all, we really want to know how our soil is, how healthy is our soil. Then we can be able to use our small money that we have to get the right nutrients that we need or the right fertilizer to be able to make it. And you said very well, we also are trying to treat farming like a business. We had an extension officer that came by and really said, yes, don't treat your farm like just I've farmed all over years. I know, treat it like a business. And when you treat it as a business, then when you treat like a business, first of all, you need to plan early in advance. The rains will be coming. What am I going to plant? How am I going to plant it? So you divide your small acre and say, I'll plant corn here, beans here. I will rotate in a way that I'll have everything that's safe, nutritious. So we're kind of making sure that they, first of all, plan. Treating it like a business. Knowing what you're going to plant. And then when you know what inputs you need, then we give our land the right inputs. And then knowing that in 3 months we will be needing to take our products to the market. We don't want to get into the problem of food wastage, which is a big also problem in Africa. So we try to use technology. And Dan, you had a very good article in National Geographic that talked about cell phone technology and how it's so pervasive in Africa, but how do we use it? And we have one of our New Voices fellow who is helping also farmers link to the markets. So we try to work from bottom up and to make sure that we get the best out of our little 1 acre. And then once we see that, then farmers actually start realizing that, wow, we can actually make millions or be billionaires out of farming. And we're also trying to turn the Kenyan coast, I'm from the Kenyan coast, into an agricultural hub. Everybody knows Kenyan coast as a tourist hub, but we have so much potential because we are next to the airport. We could be exporting, actually I crave for the day our products will be the ones, the apple that you eat will be straight from Kenya, from that smallholder farmer.
So let me ask you this.
Yes.
Go to the subject of nutrition for a moment. So
yes.
There's a lot written, a lot of this is old literature, but the diets, often the diets in the developing world, not just sub-Saharan Africa, but in Central America, in South Asia, are heavily starched, not a lot of diversity of diets. Vegetables are not necessarily part of the diet. A lot of food waste in vegetables, because fruits and vegetables are the ones that often are most wasted in the whole food waste area. How do you see the nutrition issue as it relates to agriculture, and at least in your experience?
It's a good question, and that's why I decided to be a farmer of vegetables. Because I realized, and as growing up in Kenya, all we ate was corn. And it was a heavy corn diet in the morning, and that's all starch. I need micronutrients to be able to have a great brain, because intellectually you also need to produce Africa, the younger people that can think. And so nutrition is very important. That's why we are bringing in vegetable farming and encouraging them to actually use it in the diets. So one of the other step is to create also Africa that diets that people will want to eat, but from their farms, and teaching nutrition. Yes, they get a lot of nutrition lessons from school. We have home science that teaches the importance of nutrition, but also practicing it. And I have a school where we're also using the younger generation to be able to also factor in and teach them. And then when they go home, when they request for the vegetables, they make sure that their mothers give them the food that is healthy and balance their diet. And some, I think in the morning we talked about how Africa, even right now, they're talking about how we have the super vegetables, leafy vegetables. It was a Nature article. But I think most of us don't realize we are actually having the best foods. Then when you come and you realize how you think eating McDonald's and all this, but then you realize we actually have the best foods. But I guess it's just, when I look at it, it's a problem of just not enough knowledge and thinking, always thinking, the other devil of society has the best things. Oh, they eat this. This is what we ought to eat. But when you realize that actually, you actually have what they need to be eating. And when it gets to that, and when everybody can eat the vegetables, I know my own father, I ask him, eat greens. He says, I'm not a tortoise. But how do I have to work to be? That's why we are planting vegetables and making sure they eat them. So thank you.
So I would go back. If you had to answer the question, what are the biggest barriers to try to make quantum improvements in global food security and improving nutrition and having a healthier population? What, and obviously the barriers differ from country to country, and we have our own barriers here in the United States, a lot of cultural barriers, but what would you say the biggest barriers are? And they may be political barriers, or they are technological barriers, or culture, or whatever. But you've analyzed this.
It's interesting. We just did an analysis of the 19 factors that we use in our index to measure food security. We wanted to know which are the top four or five that drive the story. What are the ones that are most essential for food security? And it was an interesting range, top in, from the quality and safety area of food, it was the micronutrients. So having micronutrients in the diet, very important. But I think what really surprised us the most was political stability came up as a very top-ranked indicator. And of course, it's one of those things, aha moments, makes perfect sense. Once you see with Yemen, the second the political conflict began there, food insecurity came almost within a month. You know, so that. And that insecurity is very hard to turn around. It takes years for the political will and the infrastructure to recover. So,
and it's certainly true with the conflicts in Syria and Jordan and with all the refugees. And, of course, that's the immediacy of the humanitarian relief and whether we have the resources to provide that, certainly in the short term. But political support, governance issues. Are big issues, huge issues. How do you see this?
I would see in the three big A's, affordability, accessibility, availability. And if you look at the crisis you just mentioned, and there are researchers clearly saying that most of the conflicts over the last years most probably have been caused by huge food price shifting, because once the families cannot afford anymore the basic food, they really start then getting upset with a regime, with a government, and then going on the streets. So part of the Arab Spring can be, most probably, be explained with shifting food prices. For us as a food company, and I want to give also solutions, not to see what is the main barrier, but also potential solutions. And I like when you talk about combining nutrition and agriculture. How can you make the best out of the field, not only in yields and kilograms, but also in nutritional quality, while at the same time looking at the sustainability from an environmental point of view. And this is a challenge. We have a factory in India, a so-called Moga factory in the Punjab district, which is most probably one of the biggest milk factories in the world. Every morning we get about 1,400 tons of milk being delivered from 70,000 smallhold farmers. And with our 300 agronomists, which we have as Nestle, and you could think, you know, we are not an agricultural company. We are a company which is actually processing food, manufacturing food, and selling it. But we believe we have to go out of our zone of comfort and also move into agriculture. And we could, because the water levels were sinking in the region, so the agriculture as we did could not be sustained as they have rice practice. So every Indian farmer usually has rice for his own consumption, and then he did add cows for selling the milk to the Nestle factory. With our agronomists, we could reverse the tendency and could limit the amount of rice being grown, rather buying rice from southern India, where there is no water scarcity, and having more cows. So the good thing was we got more milk, they got more money because they got more salary, because the milk yielded much better results financially for a farmer than rice. And the water levels came up. So it was a win-win situation for the environment, for the company, and for the farmer. The problem I see when you talk, and I want to stay with the Moga factor, what we see now, there are 70,000 smallhold farmers. So we don't want to change the agricultural practice per se. We want to work the way it is in the country. So in Africa, it's the same. We work with, in total, about 700,000 farmers globally that provide products to us, and most of them are smallhold farmers. The problem is it's no more attractive. You see, it's just the farming age, also in the US and in Europe, but also in emerging economies, the age of a farmer goes up and the young people don't want
to
do it anymore.
They so leave the to go to the urban areas or wherever.
So for me, the question is, where do we get the products from if there are no farmers anymore?
Okay, so that goes right to you because it has to do with productivity of agriculture, how we're going to produce enough nutritious food, probably with fewer people doing it.
I was sitting here while Jörg was talking. There's just so many challenges, right? But there's lots of opportunity too. A couple different places that we have targeted on. One is youth. Working globally with other organizations in the U.S., everybody here has probably heard of the 4-H and Future Farmers of America. They have global organizations, and we try to work with them in country to get. To train the young people to want to stay on the farm and to grow. Obviously, the scale is huge. And so the number of youth that we have to reach to educate them, to become good farmers, to get the modern practices out, the new technologies out, to understand how to be better farmers, it's scale to me, as you were talking. I mean, because of the number of farmers, we won't change a lot as a company, but trying to figure out how to manage our resources so that we can touch as many farmers as we can and as many rural communities and those younger people coming up.
So this is a question to come up in Q&A. So here you are, one of the largest suppliers of inputs to farmers in the world. Can we feed all these people without some of these new and modern technologies, without using genetic engineering? Is it the panacea for all our problems? And if not, is it an important part of the solution?
It's got a role to play. And I'm not just going to talk about GM. I'm going to talk about all of the genetic sciences. The more we know about the seed and how it acts and how it grows, and the more we understand about different technologies that we can manipulate that seed so it can grow in soils that aren't as rich, or it can grow in soils that are drier, or soils that are going to get hit with a lot of torrential rain and have that seed still thrive or produce more grain, the better we will be. So whether it's just genetically modified or it's gene editing, the role of technology, it's hybrids, it's plant breeding, it's different technologies to accelerate traditional plant breeding. We're kind of stuck in this debate about is GM good or is it bad, and there's just so much exciting science that will improve the ability of a smallholder farmer to plant a better seed that has a better chance of surviving and producing in that person's location. That's the exciting piece to me about technology, and I think it is essential.
And Esther, how do you respond to what Linda just said?
The first one I would respond to young farmers. How do we make the young people? And I remember when I lived in Israel, and that was when I saw farming, the real farming, and I was like, wow. And I think if the farmer in the rural, the young person who is already going to the urban places, sees a small farming, the ability for him to sit there and have this thriving farm and use not the djembe, and I don't like that djembe, the traditional farming thing. And we need innovation, first of all, in that, because how are we going to ask somebody like me to go farm when I've tested the different, what technology can do? No, you're not going to convince me that. So we have to look at it from a very, very practical application. Secondly, we have also to really make agriculture really a thriving a business where they can make a living. And I think yesterday when Karan, who is a food security fellow, said we have to plug into the existing thriving networks that are there already. How do we plug into DuPont? How do we plug into Nestle and get the best and not kind of start reinventing? How do we plug into already things that are working, that are able to, they've already figured out these other interesting and tough things to figure out. How do we plug into your models and make sure that that person really can appreciate farming? Secondly, I think lack of true extension, knowledge. For farming to thrive, you have to have the knowledge. And I must admit, the small farmer that I'm working with doesn't have that knowledge. And you have also to have knowledge of the climate change. For instance, I spend a lot of time every week downloading climate data from Auburn and sending it to Kenya a week prior so that they don't...
So Auburn to Georgia to Kenya.
To Kenya, so that they don't put fertilizer and then rains come and the fertilizer doesn't work. How can they be climate smart farmers? So these are all these things that we'll have to find a way to weave them, just like you're trying to weave into this magic super seed that will...
You talk about technology, that's one part of the technology you were talking about, but I think there's another part of technology. Yesterday, the Consumer Goods Forum, which is the organization where 400 internationally operating food companies are associated, under the leadership of Paul Bulger, our CEO, has announced that by 2025, we will cut food waste by 50%.
Cut food waste by 50%.
So to half of food waste by 2025, and the UN has set as a target 2030. So the food industry wants to shift the target too early on and to achieve that. Food waste, when you think one-third of food produced is being wasted.
That's worldwide.
Worldwide, either on the agricultural side, more in the emerging countries, or on the consumer side, that's concerning the US and the Europeans most. And then you have a value chain of a food industry, and the value chain is actually contributing not so much, but all the efforts, of course, because that's under our control, so we have zero water factories, we will have zero waste disposal by 2020, all that, but this is making a difference, but it's not going to be a game changer. The game changer is going to be in agriculture, we talked about it, the technology part, but the other game changer is at the consumer end. And the consumer end, and here I'm looking at us, how much food do we waste? How much food do you think you waste? The American consumer, according to the new statistics, between 25-35%. In the UK, a very good study done, 40% of the food is thrown away.
So everybody in this room, in a macro sense, throws away between 25-35% of the food that you buy or eat. It's thrown in the garbage, okay?
And
for a lot of different reasons, but just think about that.
They have a whole value chain already being established. The energy, the cooking, the water, the agriculture, all is in there, the food processing industry. So I think the focus also for us, and here it comes in the consumer phase, where we need also partners and other stakeholders, is how can we educate the consumer to not waste so much food? And this is addressing our societies in order to make it easier also for the emerging countries getting a better food security. And one of those is what we found as a major handicap is best before use and best before the people are completely...
Sell-by dates, they call that.
Yeah, and so the people, it's in every country, it's similar, it's different names, but it's the same.
You mean you don't have to throw out that salad dressing if it says sell-by next week or something like that.
So about 20% of the food waste is most probably attributed because the consumer doesn't understand. You look, you open your fridge, you look inside, you take it out and say, okay, I have to throw it away, but it's still good. I mean, the yogurt, classically, you can eat for another week if it's well in the fridge. So here, I think that needs also an effort from regulators, from the retailers, from the food industry to address that issue.
And of course, in the developing world, you have other issues like storage, electricity, roads, a lot of the other things that cause food to waste.
And that's a big sector for innovations, and there's the value chain right there. I imagine even myself as a farmer, the amount of vegetables I throw at the end of the day because they couldn't get to the market sometimes because the roads, it rained so much and The driver couldn't get them. That's wasted. But we don't know. The farmers don't know how to really repackage it to even make a pest. And then we don't even have to deal with storing it or even worrying about it being wasted. So there's a lot, like, there's a lot of innovation that everybody can just tap in, and we would just be rich and we'll be thriving.
Yeah.
But we have to figure out how to do it, and that's why we have to plug into all this.
Well, maybe some of the folks in the audience will know. So let's go. I think we've got some mics here and open for questions or comments from anybody in the audience. Somebody must have a right up front right here, a lady in the red.
Thank you for the good presentation. I really enjoyed the discussion. I work a lot with smallholder farmers, and every article or every report that I read regarding food security begins with, by 2050, we're going to be plus 9 billion, and smallholder farmers in Africa are going to be the key, and they're going to feed the world. Here's the newsflash. We have millions of smallholder farmers in Africa, but most of them are over 50, 60. Leave alone being the key to the food security issues that we have, by 10 years, they're no longer going to be there. Come to the youth. She is a symbol of hope, somebody who is young and, you know, in farming. But we have really young guys who are saving enough money, but the savings, the lifelines that they have, I've seen a lot of them who put it in farming get disappointed and abandon farming for good. So who is the hope here who's going to feed the world? And the question to you is, do you believe really that Africa is going to feed the world? Is that something that can happen, and how, if it has to happen?
So quick response by any, is Africa going to feed the world?
Yes, I think yes.
She
we'll
says
feed
yes.
the world, and we will inspire, we must inspire the young people to get into agriculture. And my friend Emma there, he's doing a great job in Uganda, and we must learn and learn from her successful system. She's every Ugandan now, Uganda young people want to do farming, and they've invested in farming. We have too. And you have a good question you ask. And sometimes I wonder, I also ask myself, do even the small farmers, most likely they don't even know that the world is looking unto them to feed the world. I always say, I dare somebody to go do the survey and ask them, let them really tell you if they really know that this language, I feel like it's our language for us development experts that we say, yeah, they really don't know that, actually, to be sincere. Even my own farmers, that's a language they don't know.
So, York, you think Africa is going to feed the world, or do you think it's a little more complicated than that?
I'm very positive. I think the world is going to feed the world.
The world will feed the world.
So I don't think it's going
you know,
to be...
You know, one of the points I would make, and I'll turn it over, is that almost everywhere you find, if you can, it's economically profitable, and if you can monetize the operation, you will stay in the business. So for the first time in the United States, we're beginning to see farmers go back into agriculture. Why? Because it's become more profitable. Remember the movie The Graduate, when the father-in-law of Dustin Hoffman, or the uncle, gave him the secret sauce for the future. Remember what that was?
Plastics.
Okay. Well, I don't think it's plastics any longer. But to a lot of young people, they're finding that this food issue and the population growth is creating enormous business opportunities, and that will determine whether young people will stay into agriculture if they can make money in the thing. And I think there's some positive opportunities out there.
I think what we're seeing too with the index and the work that we've done and the stories that we've learned on the ground with smallholders is a number of things are happening. It's, well, first of all, public-private partnerships are probably the key to unlocking the potential that's here that hasn't been recognized to date. And secondly, it's sort of looking at you know, what is the dynamics of the smallholder model are about now. And in many cases, it's what we're seeing. There's young people don't want to go into farming. It's not sexy. It's not cool. Thankfully, through the course of this project, we've met people like Esther and, you know, Rick and Gandhi at Digital Green, who are bringing, you know, small cameras where people can share stories, farming stories, from village to village. And this makes it, they're stars of their own movies. You know, it makes it much more exciting. The other thing with smallholders that is a big factor that I know people are thinking about and talking about is the role of women. Two examples here of person asking the question and Esther, it's, you know, men by and large are seeking opportunity in cities. You know, this is this urbanization. By 2050, 66% of our population will be urban. So in Africa, the phenomenon has been, the migration has been for men to abandon the cash crop scenario, go to the cities, leaving the women behind to manage just not only the household farm, but also the cash crop farm. So helping and supporting women in these, in this nexus, I think, is going to be critical.
And Linda, I think you had
a point. No, I was just going to make the comment that if you look at population growth, if Africa can feed Africa, that will be a huge contribution to feeding the world. And personally, I've seen it just in the past 10 years, DuPont's been in Africa for a long time, but we are really significantly focused on Africa in a way today that we weren't probably 10 years ago. With some of our research, with some of our on-the-ground work, we have targeted that as an area to really just get closer to the farmers, because it's a big market, and if we can make that agricultural economy strong, it will be good for us as a business, but it will provide a lot of the nutrition that the world needs, too, because of the population there.
More questions, and there are a bunch of questions down here, and I can't see very well, so if our, let's see, you got one in the back? There's one right here. Your hand's been up, and then we'll go to the back, okay?
Thank you very much. I just wanted to touch on where we started from, the issue of food security, the definition. We seem to have nested nutrition within food security, and as a result, it's one of those cross-cutting issues that we then underplay. And maybe that's why we end up with these high rates of stunting and malnutrition. And I think it goes back to the training. If I look at where I was trained as an agriculturalist, we were trained in the era of quantity, not quality. Cool. If we talk to medical doctors and look at their curriculum in terms of how much time do they spend understanding the business of food, how the food is produced, how it's processed, and how it lands on the table, it's minimum. So I think one of the barriers, Dan, you were asking, is really the education sector. Have we spent time educating the experts on how to communicate on this nexus which brings nutrition and health? Have we spent time looking at behavior change in farming households? Because my own grandmother was very clever about how do you bring the animal proteins, the beans that you talked about, and the cereals to bring a diverse diet. But because of economic pressures in Africa, we've gone for more of quantity, because that's where the commercial world is to buy, and downplayed quality. So I wondered, how do we play an equalizer game to make sure that we bring the invisible to the visible, the scare factors, that malnutrition is a challenge, and agriculture, food security has a solution that they can bring to the table.
I think it's a great question, and I want to get to more, but I'm going to answer with an anecdote if I can. So I'm a member of the Council on Foreign Relations, which is a think tank based in New York, and they had a task force on non-communicable diseases in the developing world. So what does that mean? That means diabetes, heart disease, cancer, a few other things. And as the report were being written, it was being written mostly by doctors. And I was probably the only person in the group that could spell farmer, to be honest with you. So what struck me about it is that their responses were more pharmaceuticals at reasonable prices, good suggestion, and tobacco cessation. But diet and nutrition were kind of ignored. Now, we got it put back in there, but the medical community, by and large, and it's true in this country as well, has not been educated into issues of food input and nutrition, because our medical system is geared more towards treatment of disease rather than prevention of disease. And that's something worldwide as well. And that's something I give the administration credit for in their Feed the Future initiative, because they've been trying to blend health and agriculture and nutrition much better than they have before. Let's see, there was more hands. There's a lady right up here that's had her hand. We'll get to as many as we can, right near the front row.
Thank you. I think one of the things that's so interesting about looking at the issue of food security and health is that it really does touch on a broad range of health issues. We're talking about nutrition, disease, and I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about some of the other kind of intersections with other areas of health, whether that's reproductive health and other sort of areas. What is the full sort of spectrum that of where we should be looking as we're understanding food security?
Perhaps you, the whole issue of education, girls, women, empowerment, is that one that's involved in this particular issue?
Yes, I think so. I think, yeah, you have to be educated, first of all, and to be able to know how to produce the right foods that you end up with the not having the case of quantity versus quality, which is a great point that you brought. But I think, yeah, we and our women farmers are the ones who are doing the farming. You're very right. So we have to really go down and be able to speak with them the language, of course, their language, because we don't also go there and show them that we know everything and you're going to get everything that we're bringing to you. Because if you don't, you're not going to be able to eat well. So we have to find that balance. But yes, women empowerment will be a key. Because so if you also don't have many children, then you will also, you know, you have the time to also be able to farm well and farm. So yeah, it's food security is a broad area, and we can do much. But empowerment with women and also the younger people, really, it's important also that we touch on our young people, because they will be the future that will be farming.
Anybody else want to comment on this?
Some of the correlations that we've done with the index have looked at. Just as we've looked at how food security correlates with nutritional outcomes, we've also looked at some health outcomes. And we've just done some work looking at how food security aligns with some advances in women's health, like maternal mortality, and some of the more other of the health areas. And there's a very positive correlation. We know that as a country is more food secure, by definition, that means people are getting access to sufficient calories and quality sufficient calories, and this is having a direct impact on health outcomes.
Let's see it very pragmatically. I mean, we have a program, Farmers Connect, where we try to work with our farmer community to guarantee education, to guarantee better nutrition, also for families. We look into family dynamics. As you were saying, an empowerment of women is definitely something that drives nutrition and that drives health overall in the family, and this is recognized by a think tank, the Copenhagen Consensus, of 8 Nobel Prize winners who fixed or selected successful methods, and empowerment for women is in there, but micronutrient fortification. And if you look at micronutrient fortification, when you look at that, and you said it a couple of times, anemia, when you have a child who is iron deficient, it will never get to his cognitive potential. If you don't get to your cognitive potential, the audience here with 130 on average IQ, it's not a problem if you have 10 less. But if you are at 90 and you have 10 less, it distinguishes you from being able to count or not to count. So for you, it's very important, even if you want to run a very small-scale farming business, that you be able to. So here, the problem starts in bringing nutrition, which is very important, right at the farmer's front into their knowledge, because we cannot farm products that are nutritionally viable if we don't know themselves how to apply it within their own family. And this is something which is very difficult to get across. Sometimes you need to influence current cultural practices, because I just come back from Indonesia, and what is usually given to children is empty carbohydrates, it's empty starch. That's the classical food being given to children. It is not enriched with micronutrients or whatsoever, so we can never live up to their potential, which is losing generations. And I think here, the whole community, including the food industry, we need to work on first of a farmer, because that's our kind of entry gate, and then on the consumer level as well. And again, we are facing the consumer side, so we need to communicate that to the consumer. We launched in the Philippines a program together with the government, a mass multimedia campaign of linking iron deficiency to cognitive development. Because when we interviewed the households, with women in every emerging market, the families will tell you, I want my child to succeed in school. The times are over that people say, I don't want to send my child to school. That's over. That's of the 80s. It's had to stay on the farm. Everybody wants to have his child succeeding. And once we made the link, our business growth, because people were buying more of our fortified special food, good for us. But at the same time, we monitored the retention rate and the knowledge of iron deficiency and cognitive development together with the government. And the figures are fantastic. It moved from 19% to 69%. And that changed also the purchase behavior of the woman. Because very often, and I'm sitting here as a man among women with Dan, the two men sitting on the panel, but women actually are the game changer in the societies if it comes to health, to social development. And that's proven by other people, but the food industry. So okay. Women are the key to success.
We got time for one more, I think. So I'm going to let... somebody's yelling, so go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah, I had the right and the feeling to re-yearn for the microphone because the discussion put forward is very important and very touching. The moderator started by mentioning that food security is the right issue, which I confirm with. But there's something that we are forgetting, which is very pertinent. A person's living with disabilities, as far as food security is concerned, it is how many people, if you take the statistics now, 16% of the global population are persons living with disabilities. How many of persons with disabilities we are leaving behind in the programs, especially towards food security? You mentioned rightly that health issues are causes of disability as well. In Africa, how many programs? She has put it rightly that we need to separate these issues. One, what is food security? It's production and putting something right on the table, something that is neutral for the body. This is all about education. How many educative programs are leaving out persons with disabilities? The programs that putting GIAD are very discriminative to address persons with disabilities as well.
Yeah. When you talk about disabilities, what do you mean disabilities? You mean handicaps, special handicap disabilities, or what are you referring to?
Yeah, if you take the UNCRPD, that is the United Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, it tries to spell out what is all about a person who has inabilities. Handicapped could be a word that also addresses disability,
okay,
but also has some limitations, so we sometimes don't use it. So use the right term, persons with disability.
All right, we're going to have to evacuate this place. That's something maybe we will talk about later. I just want to ask you one final question. That is obesity. We haven't talked about that today. So if we have an epidemic of obesity in the developed world, are we seeing through your index that the same thing is beginning to happen in the developing world as well?
Certainly. We added that indicator 2 years ago into the study, and it was interesting because the correlation is tricky. Because in the U.S., as you know, we've got overnutrition and undernutrition coexisting. But it is also a problem in the developing world. Mexico ranks quite high. It's also a problem in the Middle East. Qatar ranks quite high in obesity prevalence in the population. So it's, of course, related to food security, but it's very tricky to unpack within a society.
I will give my own personal opinion because I grew up, being poor, and so I didn't have access to food. So when I was able to provide for myself, then I have access, and I go overboard. And that's what we are seeing. And a lot of my generation, that's what's happening. I look at my own sisters, for instance, my own family. When we get to the point where we can buy for ourselves a food, then we tend to overeat. And then the problem begins. So we have to find a way to educate and to educate in a way that they see it, because if they don't see it, but yeah, Africa is going to get to that. And we have to start working on ways to be able to use our own good diets. And yes, but it is a problem that's about to happen. And I see, I say that's what happens. You come from nothing, you have, and then you overeat. And
I can only tell you this, that McDonald's was mentioning they're selling a lot more salads and fruits and vegetables than they ever did before. So maybe we're all learning from this. Linda, did you have a final point?
No, I was just going to comment. I do think for a long time we focused, particularly in the developing world, on calories, and now there is a lot different conversation about the nutritional value of those calories. And we are doing a lot of work, as many other countries are, again, or companies are, in partnership with how do you increase the vitamin A, the iron, the zinc, so that people, when they eat the local crops, are going to get the nutrition that they need. It doesn't really get to the obesity issue as much, but it does get to the issue of how do you improve the overall quality of the diet.
Well, let's thank our panel for a great discussion today.
Okay? Thank you.